Yes. All right.
Hey, kids. All right. I've got some information for you that might help you just in the coming minutes. You've got like maybe 15, 20 minutes before you get really nervous and you start to sweat, maybe just in the pits, maybe just in the hairline, maybe just your palms. I don't know, but we're going to take Global Regents and we're going to do a good job. So one thing that you can do to squeeze a few more points out of this exam is to underline your answers in the document. So we're gonna take a document. Many of you guys have seen this document before. We're gonna take this document and I'm just gonna show you exactly how you wanna answer it, okay? So what you wanna do is first read document 4. This is an excerpt from a speech given by Mohandas Gandhi, probably a guy you might remember, at the exhibition ground phase per in January of 1937. So I'm not gonna read this whole document to you. This is what it should look like when you've completed what we're asking you to do. You're going to read through it, but then once you find the answer based on this document, what is one of Gandhi's goals, you're going to underline it. And one of his goals is the complete independence of alien control and complete economic independence. So that's the first answer I see. Are there other answers in here? Yes. But if I just go with the first answer I see and I know it's the right answer, I'm going to write it down and I'm going to write it in a complete sentence. That's important. So I'm going to say, you know, whatever, the TTQ, whatever we talk about. What is one of Gandhi's goals? All right. One of Gandhi's goals is the complete independence of alien control. And I'm gonna take it the next step because I wanna make sure I'm 100% correct. So control and complete economic independence. It doesn't matter that I went off the lines, none of that matters. As long as the answer's there, that's great. You're gonna have a lot of space to write your answers. So I'm gonna read it again. What is one of Gandhi's goals? One of Gandhi's goals is the complete independence of alien control and complete economic independence. It all fits. I know I'm gonna get that answer correct. That's exactly what we're looking for you to do.
With another one.
All right, so I'm gonna break down number 10 because if you know me, you know I love talking about Bolshevik. All right, I love the Bolsheviks. So I'm gonna just erase this just a little bit so we don't get confused at all. I'm gonna take green. So let's look at number 10 right here. Which heading best completes the partial outline below? Always a struggle for kids, always a struggle for me, always a struggle. I mean, you should see Mr. Viner try to figure this stuff out. So what I have is an I, and then I have A, B, C, and D. Now I'm gonna look at the answer choices after I read A, B, C, and D. And when I see some of these things where I see like Vladimir Lenin comes to power, well, Lenin was the leader of the Bolsheviks. So try to tie those things together. And don't be afraid to write on your exam. If I see Lenin, I know he's gonna be a key person, a key term. So I don't know who this guy is, all right? I may have heard about him. You know, you might have heard about Rasputin, maybe the Bolsheviks shooting him in a basement, I don't know. I mean, didn't shoot Rasputin, shot Nicholas II, don't be confused. Rasputin drowned, right? Not for real. He was shot and beaten, but don't worry about that. Then we go down through here. Causes of the Russo-Japanese War, outcomes of the Congress of Vienna, results of the Versailles Treaty, effects of the Bolshevik Revolution. Well, some of those words in there are tied to Lenin. So we know this is tied to Lenin, but let's not move too quick. Let's just take our time. Let's not miss this. Cause of the Russo-Japanese War. Russo, that kind of sounds Russian. We know Lenin was a Russian. Outcomes of the Congress of Vienna. That's that Metternich guy. We're gonna cross that out. Results of the Versailles Treaty. The Versailles Treaty has been all over the place, but not here. I'm gonna choose one of the ones that refers to Russia or the Bolsheviks. And I'm actually gonna choose number 4 because every time I see Lenin, they're talking about Bolsheviks. They're always tied together, remember that. And I'm gonna erase this as now comes up Mr. Eric Viner III. You guys probably didn't know that, he is a third. There have been two other Eric Viners. Enjoy.
I hit it.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have one of my favorite things in any global regions, and that is a chart or map or a picture. And the first thing we should always do when we see a chart, and I'm looking for one specific student to answer this in the audience. Can anybody tell me if Ella Oakes is in the audience right now? If I could have everybody in the audience look at Ella Oakes, she should be able to answer this. I'm hoping she can. I'll leave the awkward pause here. Ella, what is the first thing we do when we look at a chart? I'm hoping she yelled out, we read the title. If she didn't, shame on you, Ella. I'm so mad. But the first thing we do when we look at a chart is read the title, which is Population Figures of Ukraine. That's super important because now we know the chart is not going to be talking about the gross domestic product of Europe. It's not going to be talking about ancient artifacts from Egypt. We know exactly what it's going to be talking about. Population for Ukraine. Our second thing in our chart is we need to figure out what these are. It's very easy. It's time. The only time you're ever really going to see 1926 and 1939 is when we refer to the 20th century. We have change, and then we have the actual population figures, and they give you the total change right there. What, minus 9.9%. So we know we're talking about population, and we know it's going down. So what is a key reason for the shift in Ukrainian population between 1926 and 1939? You guys should know, at this point in history, what is a major reason for any population to go down? It's either war or famine, okay? So, in 1926 to 1939, we have Stalin's policies of collectivization and forced famine, the establishment of a Jewish homeland in British Palestine, spread of influenza throughout Soviet Union, and Russia's involvement in World War I. I think we can take the first step, and that is get rid of the ridiculous option. There is always a ridiculous option in every single multiple choice, and the first one is, of course, the establishment of a Jewish homeland in British Palestine. I don't understand how those two things would be related in the slightest. All right, so we're left with Stalin, spread of influenza, or Russia's involvement in World War I. All right, influenza in the Soviet Union. When have we ever talked about influenza in the Soviet Union? Never. We're left with two options. Both of them are war or famine. This is exactly what we talked about. You guys should be able to look at World War I, though, and use the information up here to rule that out. World War I is 1914 to 1918. We can get rid of that, and we are left simply with one. We can do an elimination process for every single multiple choice. It's just using your logic and making the best judgment.
Well, Mr. Viner, can I ask a question from the audience?
Yeah.
Was Stalin a good person or a bad person?
I see
that you're Stalin right now. Stalin was a bad person. He did terrible things. Most of the time, Stalin's answers are going to be bad things.
Bad things.
All right, very good.
Bad things.
Bad things.
Anytime.
Alright, let's talk about best judgment. When we look at multiple choice, it's always important to use your best judgment. And a lot of times, the Regents wants to give you hints because they want you to do well. So, if we were to look at question 12, the first thing that stands out to my eyeballs is this idea that totalitarianism is in italics. Ooh, that must mean it's important. It is important. So, the question's going to be about totalitarianism. When you see something in italics, that means that that's what they want you to look for. And if we were to look through the choices and move forward, we'd be able to see that this idea of something being total or total control is going to come in and be helpful because it's going to be all about how totalitarianism had total control of society. When we look at the Regents as well, they're not only going to italicize things, but they're also going to put things using proper nouns and capitalization. So, when we look over at this question, we can see capital T, capital E. This is a proper noun. The Truman Doctrine, the Marshall Plan are proper nouns, which means that they are something very specific. And so the Regents wants you to use your judgment to help you figure out the correct answer. And they're going to try to give you as many hints as possible. So don't be afraid. Trust your gut. It's going to be helpful. Yes, yes, Mr. Gould.
Yeah, Mr. Reimer, can I mark up my test? Can I write all over my test?
Absolutely.
It's my test?
It's your test.
I can write all over it?
As much as you want.
And I should, shouldn't I?
You should. Cross things out. Don't second guess yourself. You'll do fine.
Can I use crayons?
As long as you don't use it on your answer sheet.
What do I have to use on my answer sheet?
You need to use the pen that you have been provided with.
Blue pen.
Blue pen.
Thank you.
I like blue pen.
Are we good?
All right, party people. We are at a point where really the rubber meets the road. You're probably, by the time you get to your thematic essay, you're maybe 45 minutes to even an hour into your test. You still have plenty of time. Relax. When we get to the thematic essay, is he still mocking me behind me? Oh, I hate that. All right, so when we get to the essay, you've got, like, for this essay, and this is not your essay, remember, we haven't seen your test yet, but when you get to your essay, you've got a list of people in this essay, and all of these people are able to be seen within the whole of the multiple choice. In other words, there were questions on the multiple choice that referred to John Locke, referred to Adam Smith. All right, nothing referred to Olympia. That's like a throwaway.
But the Declaration of the Rights of Women or the Rights of Man could very well have appeared in the multiple choice.
Exactly. Because when you start to see these things, and it's why we want you to use your multiple choice, you want to go back. You should have already marked it up. You want to go back and use that multiple choice. So, Mr. Viner.
Yes.
What's the best use of my multiple choice?
Well, the best use of my multiple choice is to use it as sort of an outside information for any essay I write. Guys, you have access to that packet the whole time you take the test. So don't be afraid.
They hide things in there. Like, they hide answers in there that you can find.
Like, flip puzzle back. Pieces. You're like, oh, Karl Marx, I think there was a question about that. Let's see if I can piece anything out of that. You can use that for your outside information.
For both your thematic and your DBQ. It's very, very helpful.
Yay. It's
okay, ultimately, don't give up on your exam. Take your time, be patient, do your best.
The test is designed to help you succeed. Be confident, use it as a tool, you're gonna do fine. If you have a question, we're here to help as much as we legally can.
Just raise your hand, we'll come over and we'll see what we can do. And sometimes just taking a pause like that allows you to settle your mind and things become clearer. All right, let's get out of here.
Let's go.
All right, after you.